And we're recording. Cool. Ugh, I don't want to go into another week, another episode, even if it's the last one. Ugh, business as usual. I need something to lift my spirits up. Oh, maybe some new theme music. Hey DJ, play the new theme song, please. Hey everybody, welcome to the last CreaseCast of the season, technically. This is the last bit, this is the last episode before I go on a long break. You know, a lot of episodes. Again, we've been in hockey mode for a very long time over the course of over a year. And, you know, I'm ready to call it a day. And especially considering the events of the last 4 days, I am exhausted, I'm annoyed, I'm angry, I am just everything at once. I am I'm just hopped up on nitro cold brew right now that I just got from the grocery store. Delicious. Okay. What's happened today? Basically, I'm recording this on the 12th, Monday. Happy Thanksgiving, of course. Happy Canadian Thanksgiving to everybody. Hope your Thanksgiving had something to be thankful for that the Canucks, which of course the Canucks don't have right now. I'm not dying inside. No one's dying inside. We're all doing great. Okay. What's happened basically? So there was the draft, which seems like a month ago at this point. The Canucks did overall as best they could with, you know, no first round pick, no second round pick. They had traded those away. They did the best they could. Yoni Yermo is supposed to be great for starters. Like, Yoni Yermo looks awesome. Victor Persson, am I pronouncing that correctly? In the last round, somebody who's going to play for the Kamloops Blazers. So we're going to get to see him a lot whenever the WHL comes back, which is nice. Canucks don't have a lot of WHL guys usually in their system, especially guys in particular who play against the Giants or locally on a regular basis. So it's nice to, you know, as somebody who does go, who usually when the season's on goes to those games, it's nice to know that I'm going to get to go back there, that I'm going to get to go back there and see when, if they're letting media in, of course, and see a local prospect as he's growing, even if it is a seventh round guy versus, you know, a top flight prospect or something, it's still great. They definitely went for big bodies, which is a little concerning. Yoni Yermo, of course, they went, he's big, but he's quick, which is what I asked the Canucks to go looking for. It's, you know, you shouldn't sacrifice speed for height, but if you can find somebody with both, that's fantastic. That's a fantastic hard to get addition to your team. Then free agency started on Friday, which was it's been a mess. It's been an absolute mess, to say the least. This 4-day weekend has aged all of us on Canucks in Canuck land a ton, and it's been I'm not going to mince words. It was a disaster. This has been a disaster of a weekend for the Canucks. Yes, they made the right decision on Braden Holtby or on Jacob Markstrom. Jacob Markstrom, of course, walks over to the Calgary Flames. As I pull up that contract really quick, for a 6-year deal worth $6 million per, so $36 million in total. That was the right decision by the Canucks. Like, that in particular was the decision at the beginning of the week where I looked at, I think a lot of us looked at, it's like, okay, this is the right call. It's the toughest decision to make, but it's the right call at the end of the day. You have Demko coming. You're much better off letting Demko take over the net for now, finding a nice stopgap, which they did in Braden Holtby. I like that contract. We'll get into Holtby in a little bit in a second. But that's a little bit for later. You know, and with Markstrom, that contract was simply too much for them to pay for such an older guy. You are much better off, if you're the Canucks, letting him walk, signing a cheaper guy for a short-term deal, which they did with Holtby, 2 year for only a 2-year deal. It's a very team-friendly deal, and you have Demko ready. And by that point, by the time Holtby's contract ends, Mike DiPietro should be ready to go. So that's great. That's a good decision, which of course means that you've now freed up money to sign somebody, to re-sign somebody else, particularly, specifically someone like, I don't know, a Troy Stetcher or a Tyler Toffoli or a Chris, or how about a Chris Tanev? Maybe if you can find him on a cheap deal. They got no one. They ended up with absolutely no one. The Canucks, besides Braden Holtby, signed absolutely no one new. The Canucks completely whiffed on the weekend. They got Tyler Mott back, which is, you know, okay, that's fine. That's you know, $1 million. Okay, decent depth signing, whatever. You know, they signed a couple guys back. Like Zach McEwen came back, of course, which I like. But overall, they got no one. They lost all of their free agents this weekend. All of them. They lost every single one of them. They did not move out any of their very expensive depth players to another team, which they absolutely should have done. And here we are. Here we are 4 days later, and the Canucks look horrible. They are a shell of what they once were. Like, and it's not even so much that they lost the players. Like, if they were getting overpaid, crazy big contracts, that was a problem. Like, if they were coming getting way too much money, then it'd be like, well, okay, you weren't gonna pay that. It's a good thing you didn't pay that. That's fine. Let them go. Let them go. They let a lot of guys go who were on very team-friendly contracts, who signed for very friendly deals because of a lot of stupidity, because of very stupid planning. When they lost, basically, when they stopped, when the Markstrom negotiations stopped and went down to between Calgary and Edmonton at that point, we were hearing from Rick Dhaliwal and a couple other people, you know, oh, that they're focusing all their efforts on Chris Tanev. Well, okay, but you need more than Chris. You, I don't know if you should be signing Chris Tanev anyway, but aside from that, you have other players who you should be giving the time and effort to, that you aren't giving that time and money to. What, that you're giving the time to? Why are you focusing so specifically on this one player? And then they lost Tanev. Okay. All right. Time to go look at Toffoli again. Nope. They didn't go back to Toffoli. What about Stetcher? They were putting so much effort into Tanev that they lost Stetcher too. Was that the same day or was that the next day? I'm just looking at my, I'm looking at the sheet here. Troy Stetcher. That was the next day, but still, they still lost him. They still lost Troy Stetcher because they were trying to get him to hang tight while they worked on a deal for Tyson Barry. That was the thing. They focused all their efforts on Tyson Barry, didn't get him. And because they were making Stetcher sit in the Stetcher's camp, didn't want to let the offer they'd gotten from Detroit leave, they signed the other deal. And here the Canucks are on Sunday night or Monday night. I'm sorry. The weekend has been it's been stressful, but you know, also just the 4-day weekend is throwing me off, or the 3-day weekend. Jeez, I'm all over the place. I'm so mad. Okay. I'm getting a little bit over crazy here. Nonetheless, the Canucks made Stetcher sit. They made him wait because for some reason, the Canucks are worse at multitasking than I am. Why are you focusing only on one player at a time? Like, what kind of stupidity is this? You have multiple people working in your management group for this exact reason. Why? I get that you have cap problems, but why on earth are you not communicating with the other players? But that was a big thing, is a lot of these players were saying there was not enough communication from the Canucks that they actually wanted to re-sign them. They were kind of just being like, yeah, we'll get to you. And you can't make players wait like that. Like, what are you doing? You cannot, this is their livelihood. You cannot just be like, you just wait. You wait and you go to the back of the bus and you wait for when it's your turn for us to chat. Right? You can't do that here. You have assistant GMs. You have other people within your system to talk to. You should not be focusing on one player individually at a time. And yet that's exactly what the Canucks were doing. It seems like it anyway. So they lost everybody. They lost literally every single player UFA they had, every single major UFA that they had. They lost all of them. Tyler Toffoli, they lost today for a cap for a 4-year deal to the Canadians, a 4-year deal worth $17 million. So a cap hit of $4.25 million per. That is an extremely team friendly contract that Tyler Toffoli absolutely would have taken in Vancouver. Why did they lose out on him? Because there wasn't any communication, because they weren't trying hard enough, and they thought they could just let the people they hadn't signed yet sit while they sorted out other stuff. They spent so much time going, looking, trying to get an Oliver Ekman-Larsson trade done, but they completely pushed all of their own players aside and basically told them, you can wait, you're not as important, which is exactly how you lose players and exactly how you lose, how they feel slighted and like they don't, like they don't matter. First of all, you shouldn't have been going that hard after Oliver Ekman-Larsson. I should have my computer on mute. You should not be going that hard after Oliver Ekman-Larsson in the first place, because he just wasn't a good fit and wasn't that good to begin with. Like, he's okay, but he's not worth the 8 years, whatever. And I'm so glad that after this, I never have to talk about it again, because it was such a waste of time. And I could just see it, the writing on the wall, that this was going to happen. And I was just like, oh my God, if they sign this guy, if they trade for this guy, overpay for this guy, it's a disaster. They're already screwed. And here we are. And here we are 4 days later. Not only did they not get OEL, which is frankly a good thing, they lost out on everyone else because they focused too hard on a deal that they couldn't get done. That's what happened at the end of the day. And then when those other dominoes kept falling, they kept going to the next one being like, sorry about that. And they're like, nope, sorry, we took another deal. Like, you waited too long. This is entirely on management at this point. And it's ridiculous that they lost so many players who very clearly, openly said that they wanted to come back, that they were interested in coming back, but couldn't sit around and wait while the Canucks dealt with their cap issues, which they should have dealt with before anything ever started, instead of going and focusing all their effort on getting, on putting $8 million more on the payroll that they didn't end up doing. This is why we're here. This is why we're stuck. The Canucks did do some damage control today by trading a third round pick to the Golden Knights in exchange for Nate Schmidt, who is technically a left defenseman who plays on the right, which kind of doesn't solve anything, because now you're at a point where your only right-handed defenseman is Tyler Myers, which is, you know, the disaster zone already, which is the one player on that right defense that you really needed to get rid of. That's great. Nate Schmidt is a good defenseman, clearly a top level defenseman. It's been talked about that he can play top pairing minutes. Yes, he's older. I don't love that at all. Yes, he costs almost $6 million, and that means the Canucks have three $6 million defensemen on payroll, two of which are not really worth $6 million. Edler is debatable, but I would say he's worth at least a little less than that. Tyler Myers is worth way less than $6 million a season. But overall, it's a decent bet. It's a decent bet. I wanted them to hold out more and get Shea Theodore because, again, these are the Knights who have just signed Alex Pietrangelo because they're about to run the Western Conference. They and the Colorado Avalanche are just going to destroy everything in their path for the next 5-6 years. And, you know, they had to move out money. The Canucks gave them, all right, here, third, take it. I will say on that side of things, it's good that the Canucks are the team benefiting from a team in their own division getting better, because I would rather have that than, say, some other team benefit from it and you just are in the same place you were before, and now, except the other team has just gotten way better. At least in this case, yeah, the Knights are still getting way better, but at least you're the team benefiting from it instead of somebody else out of the conference or something, or out of the division for that matter. At least you're getting something back. And I don't, you know, that's damage control. But at the end of the day, for me anyway, that's kind of like finding a $100 bill after you've crashed your car. Like, yeah, cool. But I have a crashed car now that's going to cost me tens of thousands of dollars to replace and fix. This $100 bill is great, but it does nothing to fix all the other losses I've taken this week. Like, this is what it is. This is what it is at the end of the day. Like, in a vacuum, the Nate Schmidt trade is a good one. Unfortunately, the Canucks have taken just so many bad losses over the last couple days that it doesn't matter. It completely cancels out, and it sucks. The Canucks are going into next season looking way worse than they did a week ago. They are way worse than they were last season. Somehow, yes, I am one of those people that, I mean, I admit that I would love to, I was more than comfortable with the Canucks maybe punting this year a little bit, just at this, in the case of, well, let some, you have some young defensemen, you have some young kids, let them come up and give a try. But that was on the assumption that they would trade out some of, or get at least buy out some of the bad contracts they have, like Brandon Sutter and Jay Beagle and Louis Erickson and Tyler Myers. And it's, and the list goes on. That was my assumption anyway. It wasn't that they were going to lose. It wasn't that they were going to lose all their top six forward in Tyler Toffoli that they paid Tyler Madden and a draft pick to get. It wasn't that they were going to lose Troy Stetcher, who's a great depth defenseman, who's very undervalued. It's not that they lost Chris Tanev, a guy who's older that I was more comfortable with them losing anyway, but that's sometimes how it goes. It's because I assume they'd get rid of the really bad contracts, or even if that meant taking a bit of a loss cap-wise this year, just to see what the kids can do, and then next year come back at it fresh when you have a much cleaner bill, but you still have all of the great players that you left, that you re-signed the season before. This is where they could be. But instead, we're at a point where they've lost a bunch of their very good players. Some reason kept Jake Virtanen. I don't know why. I don't know why Jake Virtanen's still here and Troy Stetcher isn't. That's very poor asset management. Incredibly poor asset management. Jake Virtanen was, you could have easily sold his rights somewhere else. You just let Stetcher walk because of it. Ridiculous. It's just a huge mess. The Canucks are a huge mess again. And it's already like, I've already seen people like, I guess it's team tank time again. And that's already apparently the rumor going around, but I don't firmly believe that because of the fact of, well, they just brought in Nate Schmidt, who's a $6 million player. There was the whole idea that ownership was telling them, oh, we need you to cut costs on the cap on our money next year, because we don't know how good, because, you know, we don't have that kind of money to spend on a season where we might not make a lot of revenue because fans won't be in the building. Right. But then they go out and spend $6 million for Nate Schmidt, and they were at least planning at one point to spend $8 million on Oliver Ekman-Larsson, which means that, to me anyway, that's not only is that not true, not only is it not true that they have some sort of internal cap, because why would they spend that kind of money if they had an internal cap? They wouldn't. That would be ridiculous. That would completely be contrary to that. But more, what it tells me is something that a lot of Canuck writers and a lot of Canuck people have been kind of figuring out here, have been kind of realizing in the last couple of days, which is the Vancouver Canucks have no plan. They don't have one. They're kind of just throwing crap at a wall and hoping it sticks. They don't seem to have any real direction, because all of their moves seem to be contrary to the other. They make a bunch of stuff that looks like a team that's ready to take a loss next season and come back a year later. Then they go out and get Nate Schmidt, guy who you absolutely are getting if you're in win now mode. It's so very clear that the Canucks do not have a plan and are just kind of doing random crap. And when you have no direction, it means that you are just guaranteed to just doggy paddle and just stand there, sit motionless in the water. You know, you're not going anywhere. You're just kind of like paddling against the current, and you're not going anywhere. You just stay in the same place the whole time. That's what the Canucks are going for here. Essentially, the Canucks are just more or less like sentencing themselves to mediocrity down the line, which is not what this team could be. This team could be one of the best teams in the National Hockey League if they were managed properly, but they're not. We're sitting here looking at a team that has gotten way worse on paper, but somehow just as expensive as they were last year. It makes no sense. It makes zero sense. And now there's been talk today about, oh, now the Canucks are going to start looking at solving the cap issues. Why didn't you do that before you lost everybody? Now you don't have anything. Now you don't have anybody to go get because all the good free agents are gone. Why? Why was this not a problem you solved weeks ago, or at the very least attempted to solve weeks ago? It doesn't seem like there was even an attempt. This is my problem here. And I'm so tired. I'm just so tired of this. Like, I thought the whole point of this season moving forward was that at the very least they were going to start getting, we're going to see the move towards them climbing and getting better as they went here. I wasn't expecting the moon and the stars. I wasn't expecting them to even win one playoff series. I felt like this was a year that was a huge success. And next year, for some reason, yes, I get that there's money issues and COVID and blah, 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 and Luongo recapture, blah, blah, blah. Like, I get that. I get all that. But I'm still sitting here looking at a team that somehow is just 1,000 times worse on paper because of, and it's their own fault. They have no one to blame but themselves. I'm sorry. It's just true. You cannot realistically sit here and say, oh, but COVID gave them, you know, really brought the cap down. They thought it'd be a flat cap. That's what a capologist does. You don't think a capologist's job is to plan for the worst case scenario and say, well, if this happens, if this bad thing happens, here's how we can work and fix that. It's tough, but we can do it. The Canucks don't seem to have a real capologist in their system, like a Lawrence Gilman type guy. They just seem to be flying by the seat of their pants, doing whatever, just reacting to things, just kind of throwing stuff at a wall and hoping it sticks and turns into a cup champion, which it won't, because that's not how anything works. Teams are properly, well, meticulously built over the course of time. The Canucks are taking a very good core that they have, that they, for their own credit, have most, more or less assembled themselves, and are surrounding them with just random shit. This is what it is. This is the situation we're in. And I hate that I have to be like this, because I like to be the positive guy. I like to be the fun, hey, you know, there's great things to look at too, but I can't really do that today. I can't do that in good conscience. It feels like, it'd be feeling like I'm lying to myself, and it'd feel like I'm lying to you. And I don't want to do that. I want to call a spade a spade. I have to call a spade a spade here. And that's the fact that the Canucks are worse off today than they were yesterday. And this is entirely management's fault. This is in completely on them. You can complain about the cap. I think the cap was originally going to be like, I think 88 million or something, or 87 million, something along those lines. Let's say it was. Let's bump it up and say about 88 million. That's about 7 million. That's a little bit on over, I believe, $6 million what it is now. What is now, okay? Like a little, like, oh, just over 6 million what it would be, what it is right now, which I believe is 81.7 million, I think is the number, if I have that correct. I'm going to double check. But I believe it's around, it's at least, I know it's definitely 81 million. And so, yeah, let's be liberal here. And let's say it was 88 million. Let's say it was that full, going to be that extra, that way more money than it actually is. At the end of the day, the Canucks are here because they decided, because, you know, they made bad contract decisions. They made a bunch of extremely awful contract decisions and choices, and said, and didn't think about the long-term consequences. They just didn't. The cap, where is the damn cap? Why can't I find it on Cap Friendly anymore? Cap Friendly changed their system a little bit, so now I have to kind of Here we go. 81.5. Okay. So let's say, okay, 88 million. Okay. So 88 million, let's say it was 88 million. That means it's about, we're looking at a case of about $6.5 million. Fun story. If you don't sign Louis Erickson four or five years ago. If you don't sign Louis Erickson 4 years ago, suddenly, hey, there's that money again. If you don't sign Tyler Myers last year, hey, there's that money again. If you don't sign Jay Beagle and Antoine Roussel, hey, there's that money again. This is the point. All of those contracts added up because they didn't think of the long-term consequences when they signed them. And yeah, no one was going to predict COVID. I get that. I really do. But it's so very easy to look at ways they could have solved that problem with just a little bit of future of hind, of just a little bit of foresight. If they weren't just thinking it'll help us right now, instead of thinking about, well, what happens if, you know, we need money for something, if we say come up against the cap again later, want something else, but we're stuck with this guy. Like, they didn't think of that. They just didn't. It's, I don't care that there was, that there's $6 million lost. You could have very easily have that money anyway right now, if you just thought before you signed players to ridiculous boat anchor contracts that you're never going to get rid of and that no one is going to let you off the hook for later. This is where the Canucks are. This is the life the Canucks have sentenced themselves to. And I hate that. And I really do. I really hate that. And I really hate that I have to yell about it right now. It's not what I wanted to spend my day doing today. I wanted to be excited about the future of the team as we go into this last episode and just, and, you know, be excited about, you know, how Pettersson and Hughes and Besser and Horvat are all in their, going to be coming into their primes. Horvat's already there, but everyone else coming into their primes, you know, as we go. Pettersson and Hughes coming up for their big extensions next year that they're going to sign long-term. And now today, I actually had to look, I had to think about it for a second. I really hate to say it, but if you're Hughes or Pettersson, how do you look at this team that's traded a bunch of your favorite players away? Tanev, who you considered your team dad. Markstrom, a guy who was a leader in the locker room and who I believe both of them were relatively close to. Pettersson for sure. And Toffoli, a guy who Pettersson and the rest of the group really liked and came in and gelled right away. Stetcher, who was best friends with Brock Besser and knew the and was definitely friends with Petey and Hughes as well. And, you know, there's also been the rumors that Besser's getting traded all the time. How do you think Quinn and Elias look at this offseason? Do you really think they're going to look and say, I want to sign here full time? No, they're going to say, you traded all of my friends away. Why on earth should I let you decide? Why should on earth should I play the rest of my future here? Why should I sign a big contract here at all if you're just going to get rid of every good of all of my friends and the best players I've had on this team and surround me with a bad cast, supporting cast? They're not going to. They're not going to want to sign in this case now. Well, I'm not. I shouldn't say that. I should not say that. I should say that it's going to be a lot harder for you to for the Canucks to sign them because the incentive, there's much less incentive now. There just is, you know? It's going to make that that big pitch that management needs to make to them next year to sign long-term for as long and as much money as possible that much harder. And that's where we are. That's where we are right now. It's tough. It's very tough. I think the Canucks again could go great places, great places. They have such a great core of guys that really could lead this, finally bring the city a Stanley Cup. But under this management, I don't think they're going to. I don't think they're going to go anywhere. I think it's going to be a very wasted era. And I don't want to like, you know, again, I don't want to be the person calling for firings or something, but this is a make or break moment, I think. I think if you're ownership, you need to look long and hard at the management team you have assembled and given extensions to. This is the first year of an extension for your general manager and say, is this really the team? Is this really the management group I trust to actually bring a championship here? Or do I need to go out and find somebody new before it's too late? I really think they need to take a good long look now, especially considering there's the amount of damage they've done, the huge amount of damage they've done to their own team by their own poor decisions and just overall poor management. And I'm going to leave it at that for the Canucks at the very least. I don't want to talk about it anymore. It makes me sad. It really makes me sad. Before we call this an episode, I am honestly not sure how long I've been talking for. It seems like it's been 40 minutes, but I have no clue as I try and remember when I started. I should set a timer when I do these episodes because sometimes I just go off on a tangent and don't even talk about it. Okay. I do want to spend a little time talking about the guys who left, specifically Jacob Markstrom. Again, I said before that getting rid of Markstrom was the right decision. Well, letting him walk was the right decision. They weren't going to be able to afford that contract most likely, and it was not in their best interest to keep him. But that doesn't mean I'm any less sad that he's leaving. I'm very happy for him that he's getting his payday. I think one of those things in media is, you know, you know how it is in hockey media, you're not really supposed to root for the team anymore. You're really not supposed to openly root for a team. Although, you know, people are becoming more and more comfortable and lax on that a little bit, provided that you're again, able to provide good unbiased opinions about them. Right. Like I try and do my best at the very least. Yes. I love the Canucks. But I try and do my very best, like after the rant I just went on here of, you know, I'm going to call them out when they do things wrong. And I'm going to say when they do things right, because I care about the group and I'm not going to like sugarcoat anything. You know, I'm not going to sugarcoat their decision-making here. But at the very least, reporters are more or less okay to root for the individuals because the players themselves are good people, more or less good people who you want to see succeed in their life and their livelihood and something that they love doing every day. You know, it obviously maybe you can't be like, you can't be BFFs with them or anything. Like you're not going to be like going over to their house and just hanging out all the time or something, but you're allowed to root for their success, right? You're allowed to be happy for them when they go off and they go do great things. Even if that's not necessarily with the team you cover, you can just be happy for them because they're a nice person. Jacob Markstrom is a guy who I always wanted to interact with, who I always wanted a chance to interview. Never did get that opportunity here in Vancouver. Maybe when he's with Calgary, I'm going to try. Maybe have him on the podcast at some point. Maybe I'll have to have him during the off season, see if I can get him on for a special interview or something. That'd be pretty cool. But I am so very happy for him that he's getting paid. You know, this is a guy who is a late bloomer. And that's something I really personally relate to. You know, in terms of just like person and just being developing as a person, less as a hockey player. But you know, with Markstrom, he's a guy who went from, you know, he was a first round pick, I believe, back for Florida back years ago now, like a long time ago. I believe the 09 draft, a very long time ago. Kind of stalled out in Florida for a bit. They just couldn't seem to really find a way to properly develop him. He came to Vancouver. Things at the NHL level didn't just click for him right away. He was great at the AHL level right away. Took him a very good amount of time to really get settled into playing at the NHL level. And then took even more time on top of that for him to get used to taking on a starting role, which he did after Ryan Miller left. He's a guy who worked so very hard to get to where he is. And he's a guy at 29. This was his problem. This was going to be his one chance to get a big payday. And the Canucks just couldn't give it to him. And that's understandable. And I am very happy for him that he is going to it, that he is getting the money he's worth for as great a goaltender as he is. He's a fantastic goaltender and a guy who worked so very hard to get to where he is that I am, you know, I'm thrilled for him. I'm thrilled. Yes, it's to a division rival and a team like Calgary, who I absolutely hate, although they're, you know, trying very hard to make that not a case anymore, because they've got Chris Tanev as well and Louis Domingue, the chef himself, the baker himself, I guess, technically. I think he cooks too. Like all these likable Canucks just jumping over to the Flames. It's very funny. But also it's just like, why are you trying to make me like this team? This is so very rude. I'm supposed to hate you guys and you're making it very difficult. I will say I do want to, the Flame, and then the Flames of course announced the retro jerseys earlier in the week that they're bringing those back full time. It's like, okay, it really is just Calgary. I'm supposed to hate you. This is not helping at all. I do want a Jacob Markstrom Flames jersey. I'm not going to lie. I'm wearing the Jacob Markstrom designed hat that he did for like that New Era video a few years ago. I got this, like, it's got the Swedish flag on the bottom. It's got the Trey Knorr on the side because he was a guy who I really personally rooted for and somebody who I personally, in very early in my journalism career, hedged a lot of bets on. The idea of, like, I really believe he's going to be good and he's going to be great someday. He's going to be I expected him to get to the level he's at now, but I did say, give this man time, give him the opportunity. Don't be patient with him. He will become a great starting goaltender in the NHL if you just give him the time. And he did. He exceeded my expectations on that. But I'm so thrilled for him that he's getting this opportunity in Calgary, for this long-term contract. Yeah, I'm very happy for him. I think he's going to do, I think near the end, you know, I'm going to say, I think at least for the early bits of this contract, I think he's going to do very well. Hopefully the coaching he gets in Calgary is a different kind of coaching than they've seemed to be giving all the other Flames goaltenders, where they're all decent for a couple bits for a little bit of a time and then they all just turn to terrible. They all just go really bad really quick. Hopefully that's not the case with Jacob. I really trust he can be great there and I'm very happy for him. So Jacob, best of luck in Calgary. You and Tanev as well. Chris Tanev, guy part of the 2011 team. It's crazy that Alex Edler is the only one left. It's been a decade, which is a long time, but it's still just shocking, this like how they've all how they're all gone so quickly. Hitler's the only one left. Tanev was a great foot soldier, a guy, an older guy who I was comfortable with them saying goodbye to overall. Maybe not in the situation that they're in now, but still, you know, Tanev is a great guy in his own right. It's gonna miss him and Riley, his pug, as they go off to Calgary. And you know, I wish all the best to those guys as they go on to the next step of their careers. And yeah, it's gonna be weird to see Jacob. It's already weird seeing him change his profile picture to a Calgary Flames logo. I'm already just like, I don't like that at all. I mean, look, hell, I've got his poster like sitting in the back of my goalie wall here. I got the Markstrom like mini poster that they were handing out the game selling at the games this year because I wanted a cool goaltender wall. And I have like three I haven't hung up yet. I'm definitely getting one of his jerseys, and I'm sure people are going to call me a traitor for doing that. But again, I root for the individuals. I really love Markstrom both as a human being and as a goaltender, and I'm thrilled for him. So, Marky, best of luck. Best of luck out there. I guess I didn't talk about Braden Holtby much as well. And in that similar sense here, Braden Holtby is a guy also very good person. There's a lot of question marks. I saw a lot of people questioning that decision, especially because Anton Khudobin was available on the board. I think at the time he ended up re-signing with Dallas. There was another goaltender. I'm trying to think of who was the other goaltender that was available that I think people wanted. If I can quickly find the name here, it's somewhere. This does not help me. Oh man, it did the stupid thing here where it just it doesn't show me everyone that I need. Where is it? There were other goaltenders. There were other goaltenders available. Some that people wanted more than Markey. Holtby. And, but overall, I think the Holtby contract, there's no expansion draft protections. I think that's great. I think they did a great job on that contract. And I know a lot of people are very skeptical because he is, I believe, a year younger than Markstrom, but his numbers really tailed off in Washington last year. Again, in front of the roster they have now, I'm a little concerned, but that's more to do with that's more to do with the team than anything else. Holtby is a guy who I think, despite what his numbers show in the last couple of years, I think with the right coaching, he's going to do just fine. He'll be a perfect 1B for Demko. Here's the thing. If the Canucks signed him to be a starting goaltender, which I don't think they did, but let's say they did with that intention, then they're in trouble. This is a guy who I don't think should be starting anymore, but at the very least, I think he can still carry you 35 games a year, which is still 35, maybe even 40 games a year, which is still like, that's half a season. Like that's a lot of hockey. I think he is perfectly suited for that role now. And I think with the amount of time that he'll get to work with Ian Clark on a regular basis while Demko becomes the new starter and gets comfortable with that, I think it can be a perfect pairing here where you have Demko developing into the starter, having this guy who's already, you know, who apparently like already had, when he signed, immediately asked for Demko's number, asked to talk to him. And, you know, they've had a conversation. That's great. A mentor for Demko as he gets better. Like this is a guy who's clearly comfortable with that possibility in that role, which is fantastic. And I really like Holtby. He's not going to become the best. He's not going to get back to the peak years he was with the Capitals necessarily. I don't think that, but I will say that I think he will be kind of like an Anton Khudobin, a guy who is trusted to start regularly and give you quality starts when he does. Like, and again, that's with good. And I think the coaching is really going to play into that with Ian Clark. I think it's very realistic to think that you're not going to be punting on games where just because Holtby starting over Demko, which I think is very important. A lot of teams have struggled with that in the past few years where they bring in a backup goaltender. They just sign anybody for the cheapest deal they can find. And usually those games are the games that go south. They're basically just punting on that game and just saying, well, we're going to lose this one, but we needed to give our number one guy a night off. So, which is not how you should play it in the NHL anymore. You need two goaltenders who are capable of playing regular minutes. You should definitely always have one who's prepared to start more than the other, but especially because that's going to be important come playoff time. During the regular season, it's just about keeping everybody rested and healthy and getting as many games as possible, giving each goaltender as much rest and as much time to work on their game with the coaches as they possibly can, because most of the time you're not working on new things before a game. I think that Holtby is a great signing. I think he's a great piece to this team. And I think it's perfect that they signed him for just 2 years. It's very low risk. There's always the possibility that Seattle comes in and swoops him up in the expansion draft next year, which is great, which would be fine. This is the kind of stuff that in itself is a good foresight contract. And which is why it's so much more frustrating that all the other things went so ridiculously south. I'm done talking about that part. Holtby, but overall, I really like Holtby, and I personally think that he will do very well as a 1B for Demko in Vancouver. I think this is the perfect situation for him. I think he's going to surprise people at just how much of his old form he can regain with the right coaching and the right amount of time. And they're not just immediately like, all right, you're the starter now, have fun. If they treat him and properly, they will be just fine with him on the team as their 1B. I think that's the correct decision to be making here. Okay. Let's see. Before we get out of here, let's talk about some of the other contracts that were signed over the last couple days. A lot of deals came in. Why did the Canucks get Nate Schmidt again? Because the Knights got Alex Pietrangelo today for a 7-year, $61 million contract, 8.8 cap. The Knights are just going to run the Western Conference, aren't they? Them and Colorado. Colorado made some great deals today as well. Like they got, I believe, they got Devin Taves from the Islanders, which is a great pickup. They got Brandon Saad from the Hawks that was a little bit of a price. I think was a little steeper than I would have liked. I think they had to give up Nikita Zadorov. Is that correct? Do I have that trade correct? Which is more than I think they should pay for him, but I'm going to double check on my thing here. But cause I believe that's how that went. I should definitely double check on that. Where is it? Yes, Nikita Zadorov and Anton Lindholm in exchange for Brandon Saad and Dennis Gilbert. It's a little higher than I would like to pay if I'm the Abs, but hey, they're going all in. They're just them and the Knights are just going to run the Western Conference for a little bit. We're just going to have to deal with it. What else has happened here? I mean, Radek Faksa signed for a bit. Fortunately, I can't seem to pull it up to structure based on who signed for the most money here. Well, there's the Tyler Toffoli contract we already talked about. The big one, Taylor Hall. Taylor Hall signed a 1-year, $8 million deal to play with, drum roll, please, the Buffalo Sabres. Did not see that coming at all. That came completely out of left field. But on the surface, that's a genius move on Taylor Hall's part. Sign a 1-year contract for a good amount of money with a team like the Sabres, where you're going to get to play on the first line with Jack Eichel. In a year where, you know, there's not as much money to be had right now because of COVID and everything, you know, teams are definitely being a little bit more, careful with what they're spending. Any other year, Taylor Hall would make a ridiculous sum of money, probably. So he's taking the risk of the gamble here of maybe there'll be more money next year. Maybe there'll be much more money next year and I can sign somewhere else for a bigger contract, especially because my numbers are about to get boosted playing with Jack Eichel. And hey, the Sabres might be decent enough to make the playoffs all of a sudden. I'm not going to go like crazy here. Like if they did, it would be like the last team in, but all of a sudden you have given Eichel a running buddy, which is more than you had last week. And that's great for them. I feel a sort of kinship for the Sabres. Like I don't really love their ownership group. I think they're a little bit shady, but overall I think the Sabres are like their fan base. I really feel for I really feel for that group. They've done some really weird stuff over the last little bit. They've made some weird choices at the draft as well. Basically they've done a pretty good job in free agency of bringing in some new people into kind of make that team just a little bit better. They haven't hedged any ridiculous bets or anything. They're just bringing in a lot of cheap deals for a couple quick years to kind of fill the gap. And it looks decent. They look like they've done some decent work there. The Oilers are in kind of the same boat. They got Tyson Barry on a very reasonable contract, I do believe. If I can find that number as well. Oh, they got Kyle Turris on a 2-year bet of only about $1.5 million cap hit, which is very good. You know, I will say that signing Mike Smith was questionable for sure. I don't know if I would have gone that direction if I were the Oilers, bringing back the same goaltending tandem as last year. That was just not good. Him and Mikko Koskinen. But I mean, they struck out on Markstrom, so what were you going to do? But overall, I think they've also done a decent job at just bringing in a couple pieces to try and see what they can do next year and just see how things go. They haven't given out any ridiculous long-term deals and contracts that will come back to bite them later. They've done a very good job at just staying the course and going something cheap. Even the Leafs have done pretty well in the considering that they were really up against the cap. Like, they bring in TJ Brody on a 4-year deal, $5 million. Maybe that's a little steep for them, but I think it does at the very least give them another defenseman and another decent defenseman, which they sorely needed. They got Wayne Simmonds on a very reasonable contract, 1.5 for 1 year. That's the kind of stuff that they needed to do. Even they were able to decently wriggle out of a pretty bad cap situation. They had to get rid of a couple guys like Andreas Janssen and Kasperi Kapanen earlier in the offseason, but overall they've done pretty well. I don't know if I like the Zach Bogosian, even if that is 1 year, $1 million. I'm not sure Zach Bogosian is a great pickup for them. Overall, I think a lot of teams did all right. They found ways to get in some new deals and to make some new stuff happen for them. A couple teams kind of missed out on the fun. Like, I think Carolina is a team that didn't do very much during this offseason. Kevin Shattenkirk going to the Ducks is a question for me, just because I don't know why. I guess he won his cup, so it doesn't really matter. He won with Tampa this year, but I don't know why you'd want to go to Anaheim right now, just because that team is clearly in need of a long-term rebuild that they just don't have. They're not ready for anything big yet. Obviously Calgary did very well. Unfortunately for us. The one last thing I will talk about here before we get going, Florida did all right. Florida did all right as well. They got a couple decent pieces, a few through trade, I believe. Like Carter Verhaeghe's a nice cheap contract that they got done. I think there was a nice trade they made as well recently. Marcus Nudavara is a good from the Blue Jackets. That was a decent pickup for them. Overall, though, there was also the one last contract I wanted to talk about was Matt Murray's. I said earlier in the week, the Senators traded for Matt Murray. I'm a guy who's not very high on Matt Murray at all. I think he's a guy who was in the right place at the right time for the Penguins. Like, he's okay. Like, I'm not saying he's bad. I'm not going to say he's a bad goalie. I'm just going to say that I think he happened to be on the Penguins when they won their 2 Stanley Cups. He was just kind of the right place, the right time guy. I don't think he's capable of carrying a team and to greatness or anything. The Senators traded for him a very reasonable deal. I think it was only like one. I think it was just a single draft pick or something. Nothing too ridiculous. Like, it was a single draft pick and that was pretty much it, or something like that. But they then gave him a 4-year deal worth $6.25 million per season, a $25 million contract for the next 4 years. Woof. I don't love that. I think they have some decent goaltending. Like, Marcus Hogberg is a guy who I really like in their system. I think he's going to be very good sooner rather than later. I don't know why you gave four years for $25 million for Matt Murray. I get that they have a lot of cap space, but that's way more than I would give Matt Murray. Frankly, the Senators are going to be, I think they think he's a lot better than he is. And I think they're going to be in for a rude surprise when he doesn't solve all their problems, which is kind of the problem with free agency at the end of the day. Is teams, a lot of teams make crazy big bets on guys to change the look of their team when they're just not that kind of guy. But we'll see how that goes. But of course, we're not going to find the results out for a while to come. The NHL is supposed to come back January 1 is the goal they're shooting for. So about 2.5 months away from now. And for me, this is the official, I guess, end of the first season of the CreaseCast. I'm calling this episode here. This is, you know, this has been a very fun, very long season. I'm very tired. You know, but I'm looking forward to getting some time off, getting a little bit of a break going. This is how this is going to go, basically. Just to give you a little heads up before I head out here, the idea is that I'm going to take about 2-3 weeks off. I've got a lot of stuff to deal with, all at once right now. Just a little bit of an insight into my personal life. Not only do I have to make a very impromptu or urgent trip to the US, to my home, to my family in California, to sort out some personal stuff. I also found out recently that I need to find a new apartment. So basically, just long story short, landlords are moving into the house that I've been renting at. So I need to find a new place by December. So there's a lot of stuff coming up all at the same time for me. And I'm very stressed and I'm very tired. The Canucks have not been helping things this week. But I'm ready. You know, I'm going to take at least the next 2 weeks off, maybe a third. That does not mean the official like end of the show for that whole time or anything. There will still be subscriber exclusive episodes on the Patreon and on through lockinthecrease.com. You can find them. You can buy them through there as well for $3 a month. So and the Patreon, $3 a month across the board there. For bonus episodes and stuff. I definitely have some plans to do some more Mandalorian episodes once the new season comes out of that. Those will be back. And then in about 3 weeks, I'm going to come back to one episode a week and do that for the rest of the off season until we get to an official start to the NHL season. And then at that point, back to two episodes a week. That's the plan anyway. There will be lots of YouTube content coming out still. I believe I'm going to start working on some highlight videos for the channel just to keep the content rolling during the off season and everything. So there's that to look out for. I have one new article coming out probably actually today as well, whenever you're listening to this as well. That's on the way too. But yeah, I will be still doing some writing on Lock in the Crease. I have some projects that I'm writing and working on there as well. That I've got plenty of those that are going to be coming out. Maybe not in the next couple of weeks again, because I really would like a little bit of time off for myself just to recharge, because I'm very exhausted. But very soon, I have lots of stuff. So with that in mind, thank you so much to all of you who have been listening, especially the last ever since the postseason when we opened the YouTube channel. And, you know, started doing more regular shows, really hit we're finishing the season on like a record high for listens and everything. And I'm so happy about that. It's a lot of effort to do this every week, especially right now, because I'm the only one on the show. It's very hard sometimes. It's definitely difficult to motivate myself sometimes to get up and do the show, even sometimes, because I do love it. I do like doing it, but it's work. It's a labor of love, but it's still tough at the end of the day to do when you're the only person there, and it's, you know, it could be better. I have lots of great plans for next season that I'm very excited about, that I'm trying to get nailed down. Of course, long before we find out, when the NHL is officially returning. But I have lots in the works for that. Obviously, new theme music. That was one thing I can cross off the list for now. Thank you so much for listening. If you can support me, if you enjoyed the show, please subscribe, please tell people, even if it is kind of the end of the season here. Again, bonus episodes for subscribers on the Patreon and on lockinthecrease.com for only $3 a month. That's about the same cost as an expensive coffee drink. Like that's nothing. One chai tea latte a month. That's not a bad deal. I think personally. There'll be lots of episodes on that coming out during the months as well. Thank you so much for a great season. It's been very fun. It's been real. I look forward to hopefully doing this again, way bigger and way better next season. Until then, this has been the CreaseCast. I've been Lachlan Irvin, aka Lock in the Crease. And I will see you next time. See you later, everybody.